Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Black Founder, The Hidden Power of Being an Outsider by Stacy Spikes. Narrated by Stacy Spikes. To my wife and daughter, you are my rock and my reason. Fall down 7 times, stand up 8. Introduction. I'm blessed to be part of a community of founders who solve problems and look for ways to make things better in the world. Specifically, I help build technologies that connect storytellers and their audiences. Why do I do this? Because I have seen and personally experienced the transformative power of stories, the way they connect us, the way they help us through difficult times. They teach us lessons, and we develop different ways of thinking about things. We gain compassion and empathy for people we otherwise would not know. The truly gratifying thing about being an entrepreneur is seeing a need and coming up with a way to fill it. And it's pretty cool to have an idea and be able to bring it to life. If you're listening to this, chances are you might be an entrepreneur too. You find yourself walking around in the world thinking, hey, I have an idea how to improve that. You wake up in the middle of the night to scribble an idea in the notepad you keep on your nightstand, to collect the thoughts that are always populating your mind. You might be starting your first business. Maybe you're struggling to raise money. Maybe you've crashed and burned and have lost hope. Maybe you're feeling that familiar feeling that you don't have the right stuff, that you're not good enough, that you will be stuck at your desk job forever, that you're not cut out for this, that no one understands you and your ideas, that you are an outsider who doesn't fit in. Well, if any of that's true, you're in the right place. Throughout my career and on many occasions, I have been all of these things, the outsider looking in on a world who didn't think I had what it would take to build a world-class product. I've met so many founders who felt the same, especially women or founders of color. Being a founder is hard. It doesn't matter who you are. If you want to be a founder, it's not for the faint of heart. Being a member of this club means you will give everything you have to make something out of nothing. And if you get lucky, you might get a chance to share your experience to help those coming behind you. That is what I've attempted to do here with Black Founder. In this book, I have related my personal experiences at different stages of my career. When I started out, I worked for others, but felt that gnawing feeling that I was working so hard, but I didn't own anything. Not only was I living paycheck to paycheck, I didn't even own my own work. Everything I did was in service to someone else. I was an instrument to fulfill their dreams. Finally, I took the leap to start my own business, crashing and burning several times before I was able to get traction. My trajectory had many ups and downs, but I believe there's a lot to be learned from someone's successes and failures. In fact, I would argue that the failures and challenges offer the greater lessons. As I've said, throughout my life, I've been viewed as an outsider, and that designation has often made my journey a little more difficult. However, being an outsider actually has many advantages. An outsider has a unique point of view and can see things others can't see. Being an outsider, there are lower expectations of your being able to succeed, but being underestimated can make your entry a bit easier. No one is threatened by you because they don't even think you're in the game. Plus, the win is all the sweeter when they are taken by surprise. Being an outsider means you belong to a tribe of people who are faced with similar obstacles, and they want to see you win. There are specific people and organizations that will want to help you raise capital, make connections, and gain access. Last but not least, being an outsider means you can be the first to do what no one else has done. I don't want to downplay the challenges you will face. There are many. But you have the main ingredient you will need for success, and that is you. If you are going to be successful, it is going to be up to you and you alone. If you are going to be an entrepreneur, you must have a warrior mindset. Without it, you cannot make it. It doesn't matter if the odds are stacked against you and you think you have no way of winning. You need to move the ball forward. Knowing you might lose and deciding to fight for your dreams anyway is liberating. Letting others know you will not quit is powerful and reaffirming. God helps those who help themselves. You have to be the answer to your questions, and you must believe in yourself. I hope this book helps you reach your dreams. Today's success is too often measured in unicorn status. The best measurement is in making something of quality that you are proud of because it helps others. Along your path, don't forget to give back. When you have reached your version of success, write it down and pass it on, so those behind you can stand on your shoulders to make a difference as you did. When you see a founder doing great work and succeeding, congratulate them. More important, when you see a founder fall and perhaps have to close their doors, take a moment, write them a personal note, and ask if you can treat them to lunch. People did that for me, and I have to tell you, it saved my life. This book is dedicated to them. Black Founder is not a book just for winners. It's a book for those who are willing to try. Stacy Spikes. Chapter 1. Out There. It was nearing the end of my senior year of high school, and I did what many kids do. I decided to follow my dream. And my dream was to move to Hollywood. I didn't have a fully baked plan, but music and films were my calling. This idea seems absolutely crazy now. What is it about youth that makes us so bold and fearless? All I know is that my hometown felt too small. I needed to chase my dreams. I was losing the siren call to that confident kid in my bedroom mirror at home. I was 18 years old and worked at Sound Warehouse off the Katy Freeway in Houston, Texas. Sound Warehouse was where my love of movies and music collided. I spent most of my days after school working in the video section of the store, renting movies to customers and restocking the returns to the shelves, while songs from the latest album releases played in the background. I loved working there, but knew there was no future for me. It seemed everyone who worked at the store had the same deep understanding that if we didn't leave as soon as we could, we would all get married, have kids, and die there. My parents were aware of my restless heart. They both graduated from Grambling State University, a historically black college in Louisiana known for its amazing football program and world-famous marching band. My parents met there, and it was their hope that my brother and I would also graduate from Grambling. I didn't completely reject this idea, but I needed to see if I could make my dreams happen first. Being from a proud black family, with parents who were a part of their family's first generation to go to college, I felt their expectations and the expectations of my ancestors on my shoulders. I struggled with how to broach the subject of moving to California with my parents. I spoke to my high school career counselor, Ms. Fry. She was very kind and understood my conflict, and she gave me advice that changed the trajectory of my life. She told me that I had to live a life that that I would not regret. I was not sure how my parents were going to respond. My mother modeled the concept of following your dreams. She owned her own business with her name on the door, and she was always talking about new ideas. She even had her own public access TV show. My father was very creative. He was a school principal and very serious about our grades, but he was also a talented artist. He was self-taught and could do incredible pencil drawings. On the weekends, my dad had a booth where he sold his art. He was so proud when he sold one of his drawings. Both of them were very hardworking people who often had two or three jobs each to make sure that we had a roof over our heads and a comfortable life. I can remember many hot Texas summers when my dad worked for Sears installing carpet to supplement his teacher's salary. They did not want my brother and me to struggle the way they did, and in their minds, education was key. I mustered up the courage to talk to my parents and let them know my plan. I started with the easier one, my mom. She was supportive and told me to go follow my dreams. Two of her brothers lived in the Los Angeles area, and I think she figured they could keep an eye on me. I suspect she also thought this was just a phase, that I would go out to LA and quickly realize that I was chasing empty dreams and that California wasn't all it was cracked up to be. Then there was my father. He was going to be a bit more of a challenge. As a school principal, my dad was all about education. Think of Morgan Freeman as Principal Joe Clark in Lean on Me, and you would have a pretty accurate picture of my father. He was all business and did not suffer fools gladly. And according to him, anyone who didn't pursue an education was a fool. I was absolutely terrified. I could hear my heart beating in my ears. I made my voice as deep as I could. I puffed out my chest and walked up to my dad, who was in the kitchen making dinner, and dropped the hammer. "Dad, I've made a decision. I'm moving to California to follow my dreams." "Oh, really?" my father asked. As a parent myself now, I've come to realize this was more a question of my sanity than anything else. "How much money do you have?" Proudly, I told him, $300. He just raised his eyebrow in response. I hurriedly added that I would be taking only a year off and then would go to college. That wasn't really my plan, but I was confident that I would be so successful before the year was out that he would have no objections to my decision. I braced myself for his rebuttal or his outrage, but he just sighed deeply, shaking his head. It wasn't a resounding yes, but it also wasn't a no. I'm sure he figured I would be calling to come home by the time I hit Albuquerque. I had a little pickup truck, and I made my way to my Uncle Joe's house. He and his family actually lived in Orange County. I didn't realize how far it was from LA, but it was okay because I had a nothing is going to stop me attitude, and I was excited for what lay ahead. The drive from Texas to California seemed to fly by. The exhilarating feeling of freedom fueled me. I only stopped twice on the way, but by the time I arrived at my uncle's house, it was pretty late, and I was exhausted. I parked on the street, and I knew I couldn't leave all my stuff in the flatbed of my truck, but I didn't want to wake up the whole house taking it inside. Not that I had much. I had packed my things into three large black trash bags to prevent my belongings from getting wet on my drive. I decided I would just drag the bags into the garage and sort them out in the morning. When I called my uncle earlier, he told me he would leave a key in the mailbox for me, and I should just head to the den and get some sleep. So I let myself in and passed out on the couch, that my Aunt Norma had set up for me. When I woke up the next morning, I heard the clatter of dishes and smell of breakfast and brewing coffee. Norma and my cousins greeted me warmly and quickly made me a plate. As I was eating, I saw my uncle coming in from the garage and I said to him, "I'll move those bags in just a bit." "Which bags?" I said, "Those heavy black trash bags." He laughed and said, "I thought those were trash. What's in them?" "Everything." I ran outside to see the garbage truck making the turn at the end of the street. I ran after it screaming, but it didn't stop. All my belongings were gone. When I walked back into the house, I could tell everyone was trying hard not to laugh. My uncle said, "Hey, a word of advice. Don't put your things in trash bags. People might think they're trash." The family got a kick out of that and burst out laughing. Things were off to a great start. Orange County was in a housing boom, and I was able to get work doing day labor building houses. I mostly moved lumber. I saved everything I made until I had enough money to move into an apartment in Sherman Oaks with a roommate named Todd. Todd had two or three jobs at any given time, and we rarely saw each other. I soon realized you needed more than one job to get by in this city. And in short order, I had three jobs. By day, I worked as a gopher at a video sales company. By night, I loaded trucks for UPS. On weekends, I did concert security. And in my spare time, I worked on my music. I was busy hustling, but it was good, clean living, and I was young. My parents were proud to see me working hard and making my way in the world. They even came out to visit me and made sure I was living right. Unfortunately, I got injured working at the UPS job. I pulled a muscle lifting a very small but deceptively heavy box and was put on medical leave. And that was all it took to get me introduced to an entirely new set of friends and SoCal nightlife. Let's just say I fell in with some very bad characters and doing things I was not writing home about. It was the San Fernando Valley in 1987. The crowd I ran with was filled with foolish bravado and took me places I'd never seen. I couldn't believe how far and how fast I had fallen. I was afraid of who I had become. My family began to worry. I wasn't calling home anymore. My grandmother called one day and left me a message saying that they had been praying for me at church, and she had been saying her rosary over me. I hated that my family was worried. I decided to invite my Uncle Joe and his family over to show them I was doing okay. My apartment building had a nice pool and picnic tables and barbecue grills. We'd have a cookout and the kids could play in the pool. I knew this would be a great opportunity to calm my family down and let them know I had everything under control. I was actually excited to have them come over. Early the morning of the cookout, I went out for groceries and got everything ready. I told myself I was not going to touch anything that day. I was going to show them I got this. I told Uncle Joe to arrive at noon. By 11, I was getting antsy. I wanted everything to be perfect. I didn't want to mess anything up. I thought I would do a little something to help take the edge off. I didn't want to have the monkey on my back with the kids around. A voice in my head told me that was a bad idea, but I did it anyway. I started to relax. I felt good, so good that I must have dozed off. The intercom buzzer startled me. They had arrived. I told them to go straight back to the pool, that I just needed to grab some things, and I would be right there. I never made it. I never saw them. I came to the next day. There was a note under my door. We hope you're okay. We don't know what happened to you. My answering machine was blinking. The machine was full. The first messages were from my uncle. Then my mother called, 3 times. The voices on the messages were concerned, then angry and fed up. I was so sick, I felt like I was going to die. But I knew I needed to face the music. I called my mother and braced myself, but she didn't scream and holler. In a calm voice, she just said, "Son, I think you have a problem." Just like my father did when he returned from World War II. "I'm afraid for you, but I don't want to sit around and watch you kill yourself just like he did. It breaks my heart, but I have accepted your death," and she hung up. The room was spinning, and it felt like an elephant was sitting on my chest. I dropped the phone and realized I couldn't feel the fingers on my right hand. I felt like I was freezing. At that moment, my roommate, Todd, walked through the door. He said, "Man, you look awful. Are you okay?" I shook my head, not able to make eye contact with him. I felt both scared and ashamed. He asked if I needed help, and I just nodded. Then he asked if I would like him to take me to the hospital, and I nodded again. It was a hot October day, and Todd had the windows of his red Camaro down, but I was so cold. I felt like I had the flu. Maybe that was it. Maybe I was just sick. I really don't remember them checking me into the hospital. The first couple of days were a blur. By the third day, I was ready to go. The doctors had talked to me, but I was sure it was all a mistake. They were overreacting. They said I had a mild heart attack, but that was impossible. I just needed to get out of there. I let the nurses know that I was feeling much better and that I would be going home soon. I had to get back to my job. My bosses at the video company were going to fire me. I had already missed 2 days of work, and they had no idea where I was. The nurses allowed me to call my boss, William. He was a good guy, and he liked me, but I knew he was going to be angry. I explained what was going on and assured him I would be at work the next day. "You'll do no such thing," William hollered. "If you leave the hospital before the doctors say you should, you won't have a job to come back to." What? Was he conspiring with the hospital? I didn't need this place. I just had a bad weekend. They transferred me to another floor and said I had to take part in some program. It felt like a prison. I had to sit in these meetings and speakers would come in and talk. Well, I wasn't interested, and I didn't believe a word they were saying. And I wasn't shy about letting them know how unhappy I was to be there. One of the other inmates told me to shut up, that I was disturbing the meeting, before stomping off. Yeah, whatever. Before I knew it, the snitch returned with Nurse Barbara. Think Nurse Ratched from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Nurse Barbara said, "Mr. Spikes, can I see you in my office?" I glared at the snitch as I left the room. Nurse Barbara told me to sit down. Her office was small and cramped, but well organized. She was silent for a few minutes, just looking at me. And then she said, "You don't seem to want to be here, Mr. Spikes. These hospital beds are hard to come by. You're here because you have insurance to pay for this, but there is a waiting list for these beds. What we don't tolerate is anyone preventing others from getting the recovery they need. And Mr. Spikes, you are robbing others of that opportunity. I have warned you before, and this was the last time. I want you out of my hospital." I couldn't agree with her more. I wanted out too. She stood up and opened her office door. Just as I was about to walk out, she stopped me and said, "There's one more thing that I want to tell you. You are young and you could have your whole life ahead of you, but you're going to walk out of here and end up coming back in a body bag. I don't feel sorry for you. I feel sorry for anyone who loves and cares about you, because you're going to break their heart. And it's such a waste. Now get out of my hospital. I walked out of her office and she slammed the door behind me. Shaken, I went back to my room and began packing my things. Nurse Barbara had scared me, and I could believe that perhaps my life was in more danger than I knew. I heard my grandmother's voice saying she was praying for me. I heard my mother acknowledging my death. I knew I had caused my family so much pain. The reality of my impact on others came crashing in. I began to weep, crying ugly tears. I had been so selfish, just thinking about having fun. But I had put my life in danger so many times, never thinking of the consequences. Just at that moment, I heard a loud commotion outside my room. I heard a door bang open and voices shouting commands. I peeked out and saw a gurney being rushed down the hall. A man was sitting on top of a girl, pumping her chest while doctors and paramedics ran alongside. They wheeled the gurney into a room. I remember seeing the bottom of the girl's feet, blackened with dirt, clearly from walking without shoes. The door closed, and people were walking frantically in and out of the room. Then I heard one of the paramedics talking to a nurse just outside my door. The girl was a heroin addict who'd OD'd. They had been able to revive her, but didn't think she would make it through the night. The staff knew her. She had been there before. I went back into my room and sat quietly on the edge of my bed, knowing there was a young woman fighting for her life just down the hall. And somehow, thinking about that girl and my grandfather, my mother's father, who I never met, I knew that if I walked out of that hospital that day, there was a good chance I would fulfill Nurse Barbara's prophecy. I slid down on the side of my bed and got on my knees. My prayer was simple. Please, God, help me, and I swear I will never drink or take drugs ever again. I will do whatever it takes. Don't let me die. I was 19 years old, and with God's help, I have not had a drink or drug since. Chapter 2, All That Glitters. Throughout my journey, I've had countless guides I have met along the way. Guides who have introduced me to the world, showed me what traps to avoid, and helped light the way. You will get to meet many of them in this book. I found such a person at my first real job in Los Angeles, where I returned when I got out of the hospital. I worked at a company called Power Sports American Video in Encino, which was actually made up of two different companies. Power Sports licensed ESPN racing, such as Formula One, motocross, off-road racing, and more. There was a strong cult following for these titles. We would repackage the races, cutting them with music and exciting edits. At the end of the year, we would do a compilation of all the crashes called the Havoc series. These titles were big with the late night direct response market. Did you ever watch late night television and see one of those as seen on TV commercials? It might have been for a high speed blender or something. The announcer quotes a super low price like $19.99 and says, "But wait, there's more." Then they would throw in a bunch of other items and then again say, "But wait, there's more. If you call within the next 30 minutes, we'll throw in a free set of knives." A 1-800 number would flash across the screen and the words, "Call now, limited time offer," would pulsate. That's direct response marketing. So imagine that with racing videos and heavy metal music. American Video, the other division, licensed low-budget titles from the studios and packaged them as space filler titles in your favorite video store. We worked out of a three-bedroom house just off Ventura Boulevard. The company was owned by two Israeli Jews, William, the CEO, and his business partner, Joe. The total staff was about 7 people. What was amazing about working for them was that for a large part of the day, I would just hear Hebrew. I knew a little bit of Spanish growing up in Texas, but Hebrew was something else. I loved the language. I was around the same age as William's sons, who would come and work in the office sometimes after school and during the summer. William's wife, Mickey, treated me like I was her own child. She would say, "Stacy, we're going to send you to Israel to live on a kibbutz, and you're going to meet a nice Jewish girl." And I really did feel like part of the family. If it wasn't for William and Joe threatening the loss of my job, I would have never stayed in rehab. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say they probably saved my life. The job itself was exciting at times, and I learned a lot of skills that serve me to this day. And working there was entertaining. Joe and William were crazy negotiators. These guys fought over every penny. I remember Joe on the phone having a screaming match with someone on the other end of the line. He would yell, "You're trying to rob me. Do I look like I'm an idiot? You must think I'm stupid. This invoice says $5,000. I thought we were friends. If this is how you treat your friends, then how do you treat your enemies?" On and on, the battles would go. Every now and then, he'd hang up, slamming the phone receiver down, and then continue arguing with the phone, even though no one was there. The vendor would call back, and there'd be more yelling. Then, all of a sudden, a price would be reached, and there was peace. There was laughter, and then they'd ask, "When are we having dinner?" It was much better than watching wrestling. I can't say I ever became such a great negotiator, but William and Joe introduced me to the idea that everything was negotiable, so you might as well try. Working there, my Hebrew got pretty good. I knew some basic phrases and how to count. They taught me a few bad words, too. At some point, I realized I wasn't making enough money, and I needed to ask for a raise. I knew this could be bad. I was terrified to go to William and ask him, "How do I negotiate a raise with a master negotiator who didn't want to pay an extra dime?" Some of my friends at the company told me I should go ask for my raise in Hebrew. I thought it was a risky strategy, but I was willing to try anything. With a little bit of tutoring from my coworkers, I was ready to go to William and make my request. I stood outside his office until Donna, William's assistant, gave me the sign he was off his call. I went to the open door and knocked, standing at the threshold. "What? I am busy," he grunted, not looking up from his desk. I walked into his office and stood behind one of the guest chairs. I cleared my throat, and as authoritatively as I could, in my fledgling Hebrew, I said, "William, I want a raise." William stared at me for a moment, then burst out laughing, saying, "You're becoming a Jew. Now get out of my office." I walked out the door and yelled back, "Do I get my raise?" "Go away," he responded. I got my raise. Did I get the raise because I asked in Hebrew? Perhaps. I believe William knew I was a hard worker and probably deserved the raise. But what I did learn about negotiating was sometimes you can come from a different direction. It means a lot to someone that you're willing to go to extra lengths to meet them on their field. Think outside the box and relate with them. See the world through their eyes. In the office, there was this character, Lou Drozen. To me, Lou was a cantankerous old man who looked like a Vegas boss right out of Casino. As far as I could tell, Lou was well known and respected in the business and acted as a rabbi who helped William and Joe navigate the crazy entertainment industry. Lou was the founder of Laugh Records, one of the first record labels for comedians like Red Fox, Richard Pryor, LaWanda Page, and Leroy and Skillet, black comics of the day whose off-color jokes about sex, race, and black life were groundbreaking. Laugh Records was also one of the first record companies releasing comedy records called Party Records. Party Records had a dual meaning. Often, they were recorded at a small party in someone's home or in a bar where a comedian would tell jokes in front of a live audience. You can see scenes of this in Eddie Murphy's movie Dolomite Is My Name. These records became known as Party Records because people would have a party and put these records on in the background. When I was growing up, my parents had a large mahogany cabinet record player in the living room. It was a heavy piece of furniture, and I loved the deep brown color and the rich smell of the wood. To me, it was a magical machine. The piston hinges glided the top up to reveal the record player on the left and the radio on the right. Two large speakers were encased in the front of the cabinet. One of the good things about the system is that you could plug in headphones. This stereo had the most astounding effect on my life. This record player was my entry into the world beyond my street, my city, and everything I knew. All my allowance money and any money I made mowing lawns went towards purchasing 12-inch vinyl albums. I bought albums from Pink Floyd, Parliament Funkadelic, Earth, Wind & Fire, Prince, Rush, the Isley Brothers, The Smiths, Iron Maiden, Van Halen, and so much more. I learned to play guitar at that machine, lifting its needle over and over until I got a riff or arrangement right. At the time, I thought nothing in the world had the power this machine had. In my opinion, the record player was superior to the radio because I controlled the experience. I was the DJ. There were no commercial breaks, and I could listen to the same track or album all day or all month if I wanted to. My personal radio station had no limits and needed no sponsors. It was just for me, by me, and I controlled the playlist. I was always playing in my parents' closet, as kids are wont to do. My dad had these very cool platform shoes I used to like to wear and strut around in when they weren't home. One day I found there was a secret stash of records buried deep in the corner of the closet. I knew they must have been special if they were hidden in the very back of my parents' closet. Some of the records were even in paper bags. Huh, this must be good, I thought. Red Fox, Richard Pryor, Laugh Records. What could be on these records that would make my parents hide them away? I put one of the albums under my shirt and ran to my bedroom. I shoved the record under my bed, determined to resolve the mystery. That night, when the house was quiet and asleep, I snuck into the living room, plugged my headphones into the record player, and put on the record. I never laughed so hard in my life. I had to cover my mouth with a pillow so I wouldn't wake anyone up and get busted. After that night, I would regularly sneak one of those albums out of my parents' closet and go to the living room after everyone was asleep and listen. I eventually got caught listening to Richard Pryor. I guess I was just laughing too loud. So before there were Kevin Hart, Chris Rock, or Wanda Sykes, there were Red Fox and Richard Pryor. And there I was sitting with the man who helped introduce these geniuses to the world, listening to his stories about how it all began. It was mind-blowing, to say the least. In Black culture, messages could be hidden between the beats of a song. The music of Bob Marley, James Brown, or Billie Holiday was rebellious. For a young Black boy, these songs did something. But Black comedy albums were something else. Red Fox or Richard Pryor would just come out and say things, sometimes right to a white audience, things that could get you killed. I had never seen courage like that. They didn't hide behind a 4/4 beat. They said what they wanted to say right to your face. They talked about racism and its harsh brutality, all while making you laugh. In Lou's office were boxes of original masters of some of the most influential comedians ever recorded. I felt like a kid in a candy store. I'd sit in Lou's office after everyone had gone home, and he would tell me countless stories about how these comedians fought for civil rights and broke down barriers in their own unique way. I wish Lou had written a book. He was a walking historian, and I was one of the luckiest kids in the world to hear his stories firsthand. Lou was a good guy, and he always treated me well. He would always pull this huge wad of money from his pocket and peel off a couple of 20s, telling me to grab him a sandwich, get whatever I wanted, and keep the change. On good days, I'd come back to Lou's office, and we'd eat our sandwiches listening to one of the masters of Red Fox or Richard Pryor, with Lou pausing the tape to tell me the backstory of the scene and craziness that went into that particular recording. It was priceless. Around this time, Black cinema was exploding, thanks in part to Spike Lee. I grew up watching videos of old films from the 70s like Shaft, Superfly, Foxy Brown, Dolomite, Sweet Sweet Back's Badass Song, and Cotton Comes to Harlem. But a renaissance was happening now, and I wanted to be part of it. Denzel Washington was a huge influence on so many, including me. This brother was smart. He wasn't just playing thug roles. His on-screen characters deeply influenced the man I wanted to be in life. Movies like A Soldier Story and Cry Freedom showed me that our stories had depth, weight, and range. Denzel was my generation's Sidney Poitier and Harry Belafonte, all rolled into one. Because of him, I started taking acting classes. I liked them quite a bit and found them almost therapeutic. Acting always felt like a return to innocence, like when you were young and playing make-believe with your friends. But acting was more than pretend play. A good performance could bring a character to life, create a parallel reality, and elicit strong, genuine emotions. Acting takes talent, sure, but there are also skills that a performer must learn to master. I found that some aspects of acting were harder than others. Anger came easily, but being funny was a lot more difficult than I thought it would be. Making humor seem spontaneous is very challenging. I learned a lot and saw that acting is a craft that requires talent, hard work, and dedication. Those classes gave me an added level of respect for actors I have always admired. To this day, when I'm watching a movie, I wonder if I could perform a particular scene. How would I approach it? How would I be able to make those feelings well up inside of me? And that makes me love movies even more, because I know all the hard work that goes into them. My acting teacher said, "The only way we learn is by doing," and insisted that we go out there and audition. It wasn't enough to learn the craft of acting. We needed to learn the business of acting. We had to go on casting calls and come back each week and talk about our experiences. I went on many casting calls, some for larger films, some for student or independent films, and some for commercials. If there were any casting calls for a young Black male, I was there. Every audition seemed to be the same, a group of black men out in the lobby, and when you got into the room, a table full of white faces. The process went like this. When you arrived, you checked in, and they gave you a page or two of a scene. You do the best you can to digest the lines and make this character come alive in time to walk in front of the firing squad and persuade them to hire you. Rap music was influencing our culture, and movies like Boys in the Hood and New Jack City had just come out. So it was no surprise that most of the casting calls were for black thugs. I knew that no matter how you dressed me up, I didn't make an impressive thug. Geek, yes. Thug, definitely not. But I didn't want to go back to class empty-handed, so I got out there and went for those roles. There's one memorable audition that epitomizes most of the casting calls I went on. I arrived and checked in. I looked around and saw a lot of brothers in white muscle shirts who clearly spent more time in the gym than I ever did. I was deeply intimidated. I was much smaller, didn't have any tattoos, and I'm sure I was the only guy there in a Ralph Lauren polo shirt. I was handed my lines and a description of the scene. Some white college kids were out camping in a desert location and sitting around a campfire. The thug, my character, was to ambush them, rob them, and take one of their girls and their car. I started pacing around trying to memorize my lines, and then I heard my name called. I was directed to a room down the hall, walked in, and shut the door behind me. The casting team had my headshot, and we did general introductions. Behind the table sat three white guys and one white girl, all in their 20s, like me. The casting director smiled and said, "Okay, whenever you're ready." I don't remember the exact lines, and I've omitted the unnecessary profanity, but the scene went something like this. Thug walks up behind the kids sitting around the campfire with their backs to him. Thug. "First person that moves gets shot." White boy one. "What the hell are you doing?" Thug. "Shut up and sit down." Thug pistol whips him. Thug. "Anybody else want some of this?" No one moves or says anything. Thug. "I didn't think so." "Stop," the director yelled from behind the table. "I need more street, more thug. You're from the toughest projects. And don't hold your gun like that. Hold it like a real thug, you know, up in the air. Turn it sideways, pointing down." He stood up to demonstrate, grabbing his crotch in his thug stance, arm in the air, pointing his thumb and forefinger as if he's holding a gun. Then he sat down and barked, "Go again." I read my lines again, this time in the most stereotypical thug voice I could muster. I sounded ridiculous. The group at the table whispered to one another, nodding. They said, "Thanks," and called for the next thug to come in. I remember I got in my truck and felt so dirty and had this feeling of disgust for even reading those lines. Sitting there, parked right across the street from the audition space, I watched other black actors in their baggy pants and muscle tees practicing lines on the front lawn. It made my stomach turn. It wasn't that I believed we shouldn't play some of the stereotypical roles of black culture, but more a feeling of, is this all there is? Way back then, I knew I wanted to change this game. I didn't like what I saw or how I felt, and this was not okay with me. As these emotions swirled around inside of me, I tried to separate the feelings of rejection, humiliation, racism, classism. I asked myself if I would have felt different if I were auditioning for Spike Lee. I thought if black people were making a movie with thugs or gangsters, it would have more depth and dimension. We should be telling our own stories. Think about Delroy Lindo's character in Spike Lee's Malcolm X. Lindo plays West Indian Archie, who is a mobster who runs the streets and takes young Malcolm under his wing. Archie is a complex character with depth. He had an amazing ability to memorize long sequences of numbers, never having to write them down. However, due to life circumstances, he used his gift for criminal activities. He was not your stereotypical mobster. And Delroy Lindo, portraying Archie, wasn't directed to act like a thug. In the hands of a black director, you will get richer character development, not a cardboard cutout. That, to me, was the difference. I remember seeing Devil in a Blue Dress based on the Walter Mosley novel and directed by Carl Franklin. In it, Denzel plays Easy Rawlins, a private detective hired to find a missing woman. That character is interesting, well-rounded. He has substance. Commercials weren't any better. I remember going on a casting call for a commercial for a national burger chain. When I arrived, there was a waiting room full of black men and women of all ages. The audition sheet had one line on it. Mm-mm, that burger show is good. I read it and thought to myself, who speaks like this? The auditions were quick. An actor would go in and come out 2 minutes later, and the next would go in. This was a fast-paced assembly line. I could hear the muffled sounds of the others as they went into the audition room and was able to adapt my line based on the feedback they were getting. It was finally my turn. After the usual introductions, they instructed me to look at the camera and say the line. Since the line was so short and you didn't need to memorize it, they wanted me to act as if I had an actual burger in my hands. Take a bite.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.